As we proceed, dear audience, I would request worthy Senator Dr. Rehman Malik, the author of the book, Daesh ISIS Rising Monster Worldwide, to share his views and give a word of thanks to all.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Excellency Sadar Hussain Khan, President of AGK, my very dear friends, starting from our Khalil Tahir, General Jaffi Sahib, Mia Sahib, and of course, I had a great honor working with Kamal Shah Sahib when he was sick in interior. At that point of time, I had happened to be a student of Ministry of Interior. After learning something, it was a great experience. And I know Kamal Shah is sitting from the National Crisis Management Cell, and Mr. Gondal, as I see all my whole team there. And of course, one of the officials who worked with me in the Dublin side is of course Colonel Tamu. He's on my right. And His Excellency, Mr. Nuruddin Shaheed, not Shaheed, may God bless you, long life, Shaheed. Because pronunciation comes like that. Dr. Maria, who's here, the director, country director for AID, which is of course under major monster rising in our country, and His Excellency, my very dear friend, Saket Farooq, who's been very vocal and very popular in the diplomatic community, and of course, all ladies and gentlemen, and my great friend, whenever you see elections, the first name which appears is, of course, my dear friend, Dilshad. And similarly, Asif Rani Sahib has played a great role in diplomacy, especially between UAE, Pakistan, and Iran. And fortunately, I've been interacting with all of you right from my, when I was assistant director, growing with you all. And I'm so happy that to see you again, mashallah, healthy, and I wish you really, really best of health. Ladies and gentlemen, media friends, again, assalamu alaikum and good afternoon. Daesh. Of course, there are many manifestations of terrorism. I was thinking as to why this has come into being, to kill people, to get the geopolitical goals. When I talk of geopolitical goals, I talk about the world interests, the world power's interests. Who would approve killing of 16,000 Bosnian Muslims, having come to the notice of the world? And when I say world, we are supposed to be protected by the United Nations, but they are sleeping. Many times doors are locked. Yes, they get up when everything is done, and they start doing the homework in terms of damaging control, but they do not take action, which is required to be taken in time. And it's unfortunately our bad luck, not only bad luck of Pakistan, but the entire world, third world, and wherever there is aggression and brutality is going on. And at a point of time, what's happening in Kashmir, everybody knows. And you know who's sleeping? United Nations. Who's sleeping? Security Council. Who's sleeping? OIC. Who's sleeping? Entire international community. They do not bother what is happening. So that means something has gone wrong with the passage of time. Let's start with the Second World War. Do you know what happened? And then I thought, and I think my most of friends will agree to this fact, that the world powers, the main players, decided, let's come up with a new strategy. And the new strategy came out to be IMF, World Bank, and then, of course, a specialized terrorism. Creation of certain groups, organizations, which work within that country and attack. And if you see the whole map of the world, and I think we all are astonished to see, as very rightly His Excellency Ambassador of Sri Lanka mentioned, why Muslim law? I mean, they had to happen to be so-called Muslims. They talk of Islam, they say the same kalma, they say Allahu Akbar before killing, and who's being killed, he's also saying Allahu Akbar. So both are Muslims. Where is third party? The third party which has generated this entire terrorism, I would call it is another strategy of war within the world. And you have seen it, how it is happening, what happened between Soviet Union and Afghanistan. We are paying the price till today. I'm not blaming here who made the blame, who made the game, but the game was there. And unfortunately, we played. And we still playing. And we have to realize it has to come to an end. Where is OIC? Where is Muslim world? Where are our conscience? When so many Kashmiris are being killed. And we are just going with the papers. We are going to the United Nations. Has anybody undertaken, including my government of Pakistan, till today, to take the resolution back to the United Nations that this is happening, my dear? Come on, let's sign it together. Work it together. Because when one person is speaking, it's different. One country is speaking, it's different. When the entire Muslim world speaks, it's community, Muslim community. But unfortunately, it stands divided today. It has been made to divide. When I was searching and working on this book, since I had personal experience and the capacity of an interior minister, when I met many head of states, and I would like to share it with you here. We were in Mecca, and there was a resolution supposed to be brought up to the OIC, whereby the entire Muslim Ummah was going to sign that we authorize the United Nations to come up and come in Syria. And that's where the debate started. Pakistan played its role, and I must pay gratitude and also appreciate the wisdom of my government, especially under President Zardari. We decided to oppose it. And I remember we had 5 meetings with the different head of states. I was sent as a special envoy, and all that homework which we did, we were able to stop that resolution at the nick of time. And nobody realized, even believed at that time we could do it. I will not take the name of all the head of states. I have been told to talk in Urdu, but there are audience from abroad, so allow me to say it, but I will speak something about my Pakistani friends also who have requested it. But having said so, when I was talking about Daesh, I have spoken on the international forum. And that point of time when this Arab Spring was going on, this great idea had been already created at that point of time when Husni Mubarak was to be taken away. I was in one of these, a very important country, sitting there talking on dinner. The ruler of that country asked me, Your Excellency, what do you think what will happen to Husni Mubarak? Will he survive or not? So I looked at him and I had a little smile. So he said, you don't want to answer? I said, well, I don't want, but still I know the relationship of certain countries, the certain countries, bilateral relationship, some normally diplomatically does not allow that you speak something which may hurt somebody. He said, no, please be open. I said, if you ask my honest opinion, Husni Mubarak is not going to survive. It's a reason, I said, when my great friend, America, states that we are with the people of that country, that is different. And when they say, we are helping the government, we are with the government, that makes the whole difference. And the statement has come from the State Department that with the people of Egypt, and a certain changes have already been made, so I don't think it's going to go off. But then you saw how a plan, a strategy, which came in the form of Arab Spring, which started from Egypt, and you saw it how it creeped into Iraq, despite the fact, I am eyewitness to that fact when actually President Saddam sent a message to the Americans that I do not have arms of mass destruction. And this message was conveyed through Benazir Bhutto. And I was communicating between the American ambassador in UAE and the ambassador of Iraq based there. And we were quite hopeful perhaps we will be able to achieve that goal that US stops the attack. And 15 days before, we were conveyed. It has been decided that that Iraq shall be attacked. So you tell me, sir, you're old with a lot of experiences. When a country, where the world power decides to do something, these things do not matter. It's a decision that matters. And you have seen it how Al-Qaeda got promoted in this region. You know who are the Arab Afro-terrorists. You know how they were brought. We call them jihadis. And these jihadis came from all over the world. And being a former head of the FIA, investigations, Minister of Interior, as Mr. Javri mentioned that I had to interact with a lot of people. So I was of the firm view. They were all disgruntled. They were all offended from their countries. And they happened to come here and cause jihadis. A name given to them under Islam, used against Islam, and of course, what happened in that war? The world didn't suffer. It's my country, our children, our generation, which are continuously suffering. And perhaps they will continue to suffer if we do not open our eyes today. Coming back to this book, I want to actually find out the link as to how it's going to grow further. And very rightly, jo maine pehle point out kiya tha ki ye ek monster hai, ab ye monster ki tarah badhega aur ye lapet mein lega South Asia ko, bilkul Al-Qaeda ki tarah, jihadi, jihadiyon se Taliban, jinko maine Taliban ka naam diya, aur Taliban se wo bana Al-Qaeda. अलकायदा ने जो पूरी दुनिया में किया वो भी आपके सामने है, किसके कहने पे किया वो भी आपके सामने है। मेरा ख्याल है कि जब सेक्रेटरी इंजीनियर थे तो हम रातों दिन रात ये काम करते थे जस्ट टू फाइंड आउट द लिंकेज एज टू हु इज आफ्टर अस, हु आर तालिबान, वेयर आर दे गेटिंग आर्म्स, वेयर आर दे गेटिंग एमिनेशन, वेयर आर दे बीइंग फाइनेंस्ड। तो मैं समझता हूं कि मेरे जो भाई हैं अफगानिस्तान में या वो जो मेरे भाई पाकिस्तान में फार्मर फाटा में थे, तो गरीब लोग हैं। जब उनके पास दो दिन में एक बड़ी लैंड क्रूजर आएगी, उनके पास रेल पे होगी पैसे की अफगानिस्तान में, और कोई तो लेगा, कोई तो पीछे है। तो ये एक बड़ी प्लान फाइनेंसिंग थी। तो जैसे आपने देखा कि वो फाइनेंसिंग अलकायदा को भी हुई, तालिबान को भी हुई, और फिर डैश, वेरी राइटली पॉइंटेड आउट by the officer, sir. Yes. Yes. Yes, they were, of course, working for a certain motive. 5,000 banda, 5,000 wo fauji, 5,000 wo log jo arrest kiye Americans ne, unko phir chhoda gaya. Usko head kisne kiya? Zarqawi ne. Zarqawi ko sab log jante hain. वो किसको मिला? ये भी मीडिया का हिस्सा है। वो कौन से सेनेटर को जाकर मिला? वहां पे क्या बातचीत हुई? वो लॉन्च कैसे हुआ? फिर हाउ जो आपका देश का मॉडल ऑफ टेररिज्म जो था, यानी कि वो अपना टेरर को इस्तेमाल करते हैं एक एक असले के तौर पे, एक स्ट्रेटजी के तौर पे, तो सबसे खतरनाक आया इसका देश का। उन्होंने छत पे ले जाते थे, आंखों पे पट्टी, कलमा लाया और कलमे के साथ फायर करके नीचे फेंका। दुनिया ने देखा सारा कुछ। अब इस देश को कौन इस्तेमाल कर रहा है? मेरा ख्याल है कि जैसे श्रीलंका के अंबेसडर साहब ने कहा है कि हिडन हैंड, हाँ बिल्कुल, देयर आर हिडन हैंड्स, बट वी हु डू हैव समथिंग इन देयर व्हिच कॉल्ड माइंड, व्हिच इज ब्रेन, दैट हैज टू बी यूज्ड एट अ गिवन टाइम। And if you see the whole incident of the world and connect them together, you will find where it is emerging. Where it is going? Why no action against them? I would like to disclose you here. Baghdadi, Abu Bakr Baghdadi, who got his initial training in the coast. He was here for 7 months. And if I say that most of these Daeshis
are the student of Osama bin Laden, Al-Qaeda will not be wrong. और अगर आपको याद होगा जरकावी के सिलसिले में सामा बलादर ने मरने से पहले कहा था कि ये मेरा हीरो है यूथ का और ये मैं नहीं कह रहा हूं ये रिकॉर्ड का हिस्सा है और उसके बाद फिर जिस अंदाज से वो चले और जिस अंदाज से वो सीरिया में गए और वो लोग जिन्होंने हिस्सा लिया और जिस तरह मिडिल ईस्ट के अमन को तबाह किया गया वो भी आपके सामने तो मैं ये समझता हूँ कि सोची समझी स्कीम है एंड वी हैव नॉट प्रेजुडिस टू बी वेरी ऑनेस्ट बट मुस्लिम्स क्रिश्चियंस रोदीज एवरीबॉडी वी आर ह्यूमन बीइंग्स ऑल सन्स एंड डॉटर्स ऑफ गॉड वी लुक टुवर्ड्स आवर क्रिएटर बट अनफॉर्चुनेटली ऑन दिस अर्थ द वे सर्टेन थिंग्स सर्टेन जियो पॉलिटिकल benefits and their own purposes are being exploited is well known. So what I'm saying is that now if Afghanistan is in trouble, you know why it is in trouble. I'll just give you one example. One Afghani, if he has a cancer, he's sick, let him land at New York airport. Will they allow him to go? No. So what I mean to say, I'm making you realize there is no free lunch in the world. The trillions of dollars being spent in this region has some purpose. And you know how we have been destroyed. While I'm talking about terrorism, I would like to safely connect it with the economic terrorism. It becomes, you know, when you do not have your good economy, there is going to be panic. They're going to be trouble. Today, if you see, we are undergoing all those troubles because of the economy. And I say again, it's a war between Soviet Union and Afghanistan, and our jumping in, actually, that was the day we actually asked for troubles. Right from that day, you have clash and of culture, you are hearing, the investment is gone because of low peace. Nobody would like to come to you because the security threat is there. Your insurance is gone to sea level. You are actually given total bad rating. Why? Because of peace. Who's deserving peace? Previously Al-Qaeda, Taliban, and now it's Daesh. But here I would like to say Daesh. It has got its headquarters now in Afghanistan. And I would like to remind the President Saab on a very important issue. He was the ambassador in China, and we worked together. And there were ETMI terrorists, which were arrested from the border, 23 of them. I sent them without formalities to China because I was convinced from my heart that these are terrorists, they are Chinese, they are trained, and they need to be taken care of. And you know, that became a good basis of friendship for us. But not only for our friendship, but what we discovered, that not only the Pakistanis or Chinese, they were almost every nation, starting from Africa, to Bosnia, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and all of them were being trained. Obviously, if they were being trained, they were not to be used, most of them, in Pakistan. They were to be used back home. And if you see the whole development and expansion of Daesh, it has embraced the world. You know what happened in Europe, how they acted. And here in Pakistan, they are attacking from Afghanistan. And obviously, if you have the and on the media, you must have seen over the first run. Pointed out that Daesh has entered Pakistan. And the first ever presence was seen in the Deskar Salvo, in a mosque. Then they expanded towards south of Punjab. Then they came to Barakau and the areas. But I must commend our law enforcement agencies, our intelligence agencies. They smashed them. And even now, when I'm talking to you, Whatever Daesh is doing in Pakistan, they operate from Afghanistan. And I'm so happy that intelligence agencies are keeping a good eye. Maybe out of 20, one filters in and does, like, you know, 7 mein hua, Baluchistan mein hua, aur wo Gandhi mein hua. Matlab ye wo karte rehte hain, but lekin wo jo maamle ya wo waqiat jo hamari fauj ne ya hamari security agencies ne aur intelligence agencies ne apni mehnat se roka, I would like to pay full tribute and appreciation to the Pakistan Army and our law enforcement agencies, particularly to the intelligence agencies. Now, having come to Pakistan, now I'll come to my brother, what he said. I went for condolences to his house. When I came out, my all media friends were there. And the first question which was posed to me, that Prime Minister Modi says that the attack in Sri Lanka has been done by Pakistan. I was shocked when His Excellency would endorse it out and was standing on the right on me. I was taken for a surprise, to be very honest. But since I had been dealing this subject, so I gave two arguments. I said, number one, Mr. Prime Minister Modi, and I'm addressing you directly now even, that you are using Daesh against Kashmiris in Kashmir. We have proofs. Your security advisor at all went to Middle East. We know who he met from Daesh, and my book speaks about it, with the details as to who he met, what were the package, and how that package was brought to India. And long time back, when I was Interior Minister, Mr. Kumar Shah will dose me out, Mr. Chidambaram, the then Interior Minister, visited Pakistan. I told him, Your Excellency, unfortunately, we have suffered. We made a blunder not to stop the Taliban, these Zalman in time. Your country is getting Taliban in the shape of something. He said, no, we will not get it because we have a very strong system. I said, they always inflict the strong system. So you're going to have it. Down the line, after 1 year, I met him in Kathmandu. He said, Your Excellency, you're right. We are in trouble. And that trouble is called RSS. And they are actually Hindu Talibans. They are the one. Our New York Times may be personal likha hai. Agar duniya mein koi mulk hai, jisme minority ke aur rights nahi hai, aur jis andaaz se India aage badh raha hai, India is going to create lot of havoc, and especially for the Muslims over there. Now question arises, why Sri Lanka became the target? It's very important. If you recall, Your Excellency and all my friends, at that point of time, in New Zealand, the guy who was there, who did this heinous crime, and while he was going live in the world, he said that this is a war of civilizations. He was perhaps referring back in Europe what happened, and there might be perhaps some plan to create that. And within 3 to 4 hours, I came with a statement that I foresee the vulnerable countries, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. Down the line it happened. Now I tell Your Excellency why it's a theory and now it looks like a fact. You know, you have very rich Muslims in Sri Lanka. You know how Tamils were used, and I need not to tell you, Your Excellency, who used them, and how they were provided drugs from the Golden Triangle, and how they were taken to Europe and many other countries. And at least 5 cases I've investigated as a former head of the FIA, where these involvements were there. Since there are Muslims, more Muslims, they had in place a friendly ties with India. So if this was done here, so this was a creation of a big rift between Christians and Muslims. And let me tell you, I appreciate your government. Number one, which they did straight away, they came up without any fear that these Daeshis are trained in India. And they were right in stating, it's not me who's saying, it came up by the Prime Minister, of Sri Lanka and the President of Sri Lanka himself. Thereafter, if you see, there was a lot of trouble. Muslims were not only harassed, 21 ministers from Muslim communities resigned. The Muslims were taken out of their shops, brutally beaten, and the way they treated, that was the part of the whole game to happen. But the Sri Lankan government, in fact, did a good job and controlled the situation very well. And if you recall, I had issued the statement to the parliament and I raised this question, appealing the government of Sri Lanka that they should take care of the Muslim community in Sri Lanka because they are at risk, because this is a part of the ongoing plan what has happened already in Sri Lanka. So, Your Excellency, this was the part of that particular larger plan which is coming to South Asia. And the dangerous thing which I'm foreseeing, all my dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, is Daeshism. If you see the ideology of Daeshism and see the ideology of RSS, they are now, I should say, they have got married together. And this has started in India. And these two ideologies together are going to be very dangerous for this region. And unfortunately, the West must realize if something happens to South Asia, the world will not remain peaceful. Because one thing can be engineered. Somebody who the team today may not be old one, and they have very well experienced it in Afghanistan, when all these terrorists were trained, brought abroad, from abroad. And just a small information, we say Al-Qaeda. What is Al-Qaeda? It's a register in which all those jihadis who used to come from abroad, they used to get registered there. And ultimately, it was named by Zawari in his 30 pages book as to what is Al-Qaeda and how it came into being. Starting from Jamaa Islamiya in Egypt, then Al-Qaeda, Taliban, you know the killing of Sadat, I will not go into details, but always see where the conspiracies lead to. All the roads lead to some side. I think it's high time for all of us. For the sake of the future, the new generations, for the sake of the peace, and at least I will talk about my country, we need peace. We are getting destroyed in terms of economy, and every fiber, every faction of the society has been deeply inflicted with this terrorism. And this issue of peace is very important for us. And I know I've taken a lot of time, but in the end, I would like to make a few suggestions to the world and to the international community sitting here that it's high time. Now, let's bring peace in the world. And it cannot come unless the entire international community sits together and finds out a common way. I, in my one-to-one meeting with President Bush, with President Obama, with clarity I said that you are fighting a war. I do not understand why, because I'm sitting in the region. I'm not just sitting in cozy sitting room. My soldiers are fighting the mountains, rough mountains. Why America or the allies have not found till today a common strategy against a common enemy? I did not get the reply. The only thing what President Bush said to Tony Rice, that is Mr. Malik saying right that we don't have the policy, what he's saying, he said, yes. Unfortunately, he's right. And it is still today right. It is still there. I mean, if the world starts thinking and finding out a strategy to block that, it will be blocked. Is there any resolution at UNO where we say that this is what Daesh is doing? Even Sri Lankan issue has not been raised so far. Well, after losing 120 lives and many more, So that means there's somebody who does not want actual, real peace, but a division within the communities to get their geopolitical motives into gear and then get them fulfilled. So I think I have advised my government also that it has to be done. First, through the terrorist organizations, they create issue, they create problems, and they come with the cities, let's do something for you. And then they bring planning of like FATF, and they, you are asked to do this, this. I have a question. What is the allegation against us? That we did money laundering. Who did the money laundering? Somebody had gone to Malaysia. He was collecting some donations, and it draws the attention of Indian intelligence and somebody else. And then, of course, it becomes a big issue, FATF. Duly engineered by India to set a score with us. I have a question, and question is, then when we started war with you, USA, you used to bring money in big suitcases to give to the Taliban's. And it will not be saying those who were working that point of time in the intelligence will bear me out what I'm saying. Was not that money laundering? What was that? Even what's happening in Middle East, how the money is being distributed, how the arms and ammunition being distributed, how come the Daeshis have got planes, they have tanks, they have got every possible ammunition with them. Who's providing them? Can somebody answer me? Are we sleeping? Are we trying to tell that we're naive? No, nobody's naive. We are closing our eyes, perhaps due to our own issues. I think we all have to rise one day against this aggression, against this total injustice to the world. You see, if you link your political system, your economic system, and of course, your criminal justice system. Your criminal justice system and your economic system, they stand tight together. They have become directly proportional to each other. So you have to think about it. The first, you have to bring peace before you think of economy, because they stand interconnected. But unfortunately, the way we have been trapped, the debt, you see, the debt trap is right there. We have over $200 billion on our shoulders. How are we going to get rid of that? And the way we are doing it, unfortunately, well, we are optimistic, and we as a nation get very happy with a little news. Oh, $6.2 billion. IMF, the mighty IMF has given to us. The mighty dollar is going up. Oh, well, when the IMF money comes, it will go down. And price hike will go down. In the end, what we get? $1.2 billion. And we already owe $4.2 billion. I say this is the basic plan of the West after World War II to bring IMF to control the third world countries. It's not only Pakistan. You see the entire Africa, all third world countries, particularly the patch of Muslims. Terrorism, you have seen in Philippines, where is a Muslim patch. In Sri Lanka, where there is a Muslim patch. And similarly, you go to Africa, Boko Haram, Nigeria, what's happening? You go to Somalia, the same. You go to Sudan, it is same. And every Muslim country, unfortunately, is under attack by terrorists, by these so-called terrorists being nourished, energized by their masters to create trouble within us. And the way the name of Islamic terrorism was highlighted, I think it's well known. I wrote a letter to President Donald Trump. I said, I advise you one thing, Mr. President, fight this war with Muslims, not against Muslims, because we are not terrorists. We are like you. We want peace. But when five bombers come from Daesh and attack in Balochistan,
are in KPK. What do you expect from us? And after having given our lives, given our economic system, destructions of the entire, almost our logistics, we still are suspect. We are not allies. Our green passport is still not respected. Why? We were with you in the war. We fought the war with you. We destroyed our economy. And we gave sacrifice of over 70,000 Pakistanis. And here, and still you call us a suspect, a terrorist. We are hurt. We are badly hurt. And therefore, from this forum, I call upon to the entire world, look towards Pakistan. We have to. We have to in difficult times. Created one or otherwise. We need your sympathies in terms of equality. We are not begging anything. Even if we beg, you are not going to give us anything. But at least give our self-respect, which we deserve. Well, I should not take, I think, more time. But in the end, I would like to thank my team, particularly Nia Saab. I think he was sleeping. Nia Saab, a wake-up call. I'm not telling America to get up. But telling my friend to get up. And Mia Saab, thank you very much, being a publisher. And you played a great role. And Mr. Saab, around here, sitting at the corner. Mr. Baki, and my direct PR, Mr. Turi, and Kamran, and of course, maybe I forget some names. Shiraj Saab is sitting here. He has translated my book, Modi's War Doctrine, and he's going to translate this book. And in the end, I'm also grateful to Colonel Tamur, all his teams for helping me out. There's a lot to talk about Daesh, about Al-Qaeda, terrorism. In the end, I would like to say, if we will not block this Daesh, it's going to grow a bigger monster than Al-Qaeda. And then, we will not say, in Pakistan and outside, we have been very long. Thank you very much. Pakistan, zindabad.